Spirit, one God. Today is the first Sunday of Great Lent, only the first. Today known as Orthodoxy Sunday, the day in which we celebrate the triumph of Orthodoxy. Well, what is the triumph of Orthodoxy? I think first we need to clarify what it is not, because people today are so used to a fractured Christendom, split into tens of thousands of denominations. I don't know how many, millions, 10,000, 20,000. That to talk about a triumph of Orthodoxy sounds like a boast, you know, like our denomination's better than yours, that kind of thing. But we have to remember that this term was coined long before the great schism of 1054, and even longer before the divisions caused by denominationalism in the West. There were no denominations when this term was first used. The triumph of Orthodoxy refers not to an exaltation of one church over another, but rather the triumph of the Christian faith, the faith itself, over a particular error that at that period has sought to weaken and corrupt the faith. So the whole controversy, and this is in the 8th century, centered on the proper role of holy imagery, the holy icons, in the church. Many Christians today, I think, especially whose traditions do not use icons, would be deeply perplexed about this. And what are you talking about? The triumph of the Christian faith? Icons? You know, pretty images, perhaps. Make the place look very churchy, you know. But icons? How are they so important? I can scarcely imagine why icons matter at all. And you know, there's a fair number of Christians today who would actually, their beliefs would put them on the wrong side of the fence. They'd be counted with the iconoclasts in terms of their opinions. And the iconoclasts, by the way, icon smasher, it means, were those who wanted to remove them from the church. They were called smashers because in many cases that's what they literally did. They went into churches and monasteries with axes and broke many holy and precious icons to bits, and sometimes the monks who were clinging to them as well. There were many, 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 many monks. In fact, following the controversy was a 10-year period of great persecution called the Decade of Blood, you know. I mean, we remember maybe the 60s as the Summer of Love, or something like that. The Decade of Blood doesn't sound like a time that you'd want to be around, you know. But historically, the use of icons dates back to Jewish times and was known and upheld with a much greater Christian understanding during the apostolic period and throughout the early church, as even secular archaeology continues to demonstrate over and over again. Every time they find a new church or a place where Christians met, there's icons, there's mosaics, there's all this imagery that you know, they can't find like an early church that was Quaker, let's say. filled with icons. And yet, speaking of Quakers, you know, there's always been a sort of puritanical movement in Christendom, I'd say. And just as sometimes we're prone to excess, we're also prone to excessive puritanism. And particularly over the icons, that there really grew a movement to banish the icons from the church. Why? The major charge, I mean, there's all kinds of social political reasons, but the major charge was that icons were being used as idols, that there were ignorant country folk Christian who were worshiping these images. And of course, if, you know, there's likely some truth to that. People make mistakes. And the church would certainly need to fully address and correct and teach on the proper use of these images. But to outright ban the icons or claim that they are always idolatrous in their use did not seem wise to the Holy Fathers. They realized there's something more going on here. The law of unintended consequences is rarely understood by the band, this or that crowd. And a closer examination of the facts by cooler heads needed to take place. So an ecumenical council was held in 787 in Nicaea, the second council of Nicaea, because you remember the first ecumenical council was in Nicaea, and the last ecumenical council was in Nicaea. So they met or were convened to put forth clearly the Orthodox understanding and teaching regarding the holy images. It was decided by the fathers that the use of icons is so closely tied to incarnational theology that to eliminate one would do irreparable harm to the other. In other words, take away the icons, which are physical items depicting spiritual realities, and we lose a vital testimony of that joining of the immaterial God to the material creation. We have icons because of the incarnation. Before the incarnation, the invisible God could not be depicted by images. You know, it would just be the imagination of men. It would not represent any truth or reality. But when God took flesh and dwelt among us, all this changed. And people could now see, touch, kiss the image of their Creator, who was, of course, Jesus Christ, the image of God the Father, the icon of God, he's called in Colossians. Furthermore, the images of the saints, showing holy people, sanctified and glorified by their union with Christ, demonstrate the outworking of the incarnation in our lives. So you see, God in the flesh, portrayed by material icons, saints, filled with God and glowing forth, you know, with this divinity because of their union with Christ through the incarnation. It's all distinctly Christian. It's all Christian. Only really Christians have icons. Religions that, I mean, you know, I know there's other, but not in the same way, not the same thing as the icons that we have. Because, you know, if you don't believe in the incarnation, you believe in a spirit God, but not in the incarnation of God, then it's wrong to make an icon. Only the Christians who believe in the incarnation can have these, which are different from pictures. You know, if you want a picture or a statue of the Jolly Buddha, that's fine. But that's not an icon, and that's not an image of the invisible God. And so according to our holy fathers, who are, of course, those men to whom all of us and all Christians owe their Christian faith. If you are a Christian today, whether Orthodox or not, you are a Christian today because of these men who went before you and preserved the faith. They stated that Christians who reject the use of holy imagery in the church stand in danger of losing the greater meaning of the incarnation in their lives. Now that's ancient wisdom, Christian Orthodox wisdom, and dismissed by many, many Christians today. They're like, oh, fluffy stuff. Of course I can believe in the incarnation without having icons in my church. Well, I'm not sure about that. You know, their warnings have come true in so many ways, considering that the veil of neo-Gnosticism has been laid across much of contemporary Christianity. Gnosticism, you know, is an ancient pagan philosophy rooted on a dualist thought. Dualism being, a lot of words here, the idea that matter is bad, spirit is good, right, basically boiled it down. Matter evil, spirit good. Matter false, spirit real, true. Even if, you know, it ranges in terms of matter being completely, what's the term that's used? Total depravity, you know, completely bad, beyond redemption, irredeemable, can only be destroyed in order for the spirit to be set free, you know, to to maybe lesser versions of that being that matter just isn't as real as the spirit. Spirit is real. Well, this philosophy has permeated Western culture and Western Christianity. You know, in culture, you see it manifested in like the whole confusion over gender identity. If you were born a man, but you feel like a woman, what man doesn't found that? But no, it's like, well, how do you fix that? In the old days, we had a thing called therapy. And you go to therapy and you get your head straightened out. But these days, because we're Gnostic, we say, well, my body is wrong. So I need surgery. I need to fix this and that. So my body can reflect what my spirit feels. Because body is less real than spirit. See, that's Gnosticism. That's not reality. And you know, it permeates in so many other ways, in terms of sexual identity, in terms of so many things, governments. When it filters into Christianity, what you wind up with often is, at very least, a kind of sacramentalism, which is not what you think. Sacramentarianism, I'm trying to say. It's the denial of the sacraments. In other words, why? Yeah, you know, it's like the body and blood of Christ is not really the body and blood of Christ. It's a symbol, because our minds and our spirits meditate on these things, and they are fed by this special knowledge. This is Gnostic. But you know, matter, you know, God doesn't use matter. You know, matter is fallen, right? Same thing with baptism. The baptism is just an outward sign of something that's already been done. You're born again when you believe, when, you know, and you don't need to be dogged. That's just there to sort of demonstrate to the world that you were born again, right? That's Gnosticism. That's not Christianity. We say that God is redeeming matter. God is already redeeming matter. That water can be made holy, and thus we can be baptized in it and be joined to Christ physically, mystically, but physically. And the body and blood of Christ is mystically the body and blood of Christ. It is. We take matter, and by matter, we are saved by Christ's incarnation. This is incarnational, this is real, but it's too real for modern Gnostics, too real for many of our brethren who struggle even to believe in the incarnation, or, I don't know, the deity of Christ, or so many other things, because of this idea that God would not dirty his hands by dabbling in the realm of matter. In fact, he's just going to burn it all up one day, which is not true either. So, I realize people think, well, no, this is right out of the Bible. The Bible says that baptism isn't real. People's interpretations are influenced by a philosophy that has nothing at all to do with Christianity. And I'm sorry to say that, but it's true. I'm very sorry to say that. But it's been happening ever since the early church, because Gnosticism predates. Even though Irenaeus called it a Christian heresy, he was talking about the forms that manifest themselves in the Christian church that St. John wrote about. They went out from us because they were never of us. You cannot be Gnostic and be an Orthodox Christian. So these, you know, unfortunately, today many folks don't care. So what? Just words, blah, blah, philosophy, who cares? I just, you know, I like to go along with what my friends believe so I can be popular. You know, if presented with facts, many people will react defensively or with indignation. Are you saying my own denomination is? Well, I'm saying that, first of all, denominations are wrong. But yeah, you know, Gnosticism affects real people. These false beliefs touch real lives. People need to take a closer look at what our fathers taught. And at the very least, you know, we do too. If we call ourselves Orthodox, we ought to really make sure that we are Orthodox. Orthodox through and through, in our practice, in the way that we live, in our beliefs. You know, we cannot go wrong with the world. and it's called, and it's such a temptation because nobody wants to be a bad guy. Nobody wants to be called a hater, a homophobe, or, you know, whatever, or a Neanderthal. Some of us might be related, I don't know. We have to be careful to be formed by our holy Orthodox tradition, not by the world, not by its teachings and philosophies, no matter how much they appeal to our sense of fairness or whatever like that. It's more important to know the truth, because it is the truth that sets you free. You think Bruce Jenner is free? Okay. You know, it's the worst kind of bondage comes when people subscribe to these philosophies rather than clinging to God, Christ. We need to take our cues not from what the culture teaches us, but not from what the majority think. Not from the hashtags of current social movements, but we need to value the fathers, the councils, the creeds, the canons, and our clergy, and take our direction from them. It might seem obvious, but you know, there's such a growing number of Orthodox today. I mean, I'm talking about Orthodox Christians who are embarrassed by the church and its traditions. They think that we are homophobic because we ask gay people to repent, join the community of the faithful, partake of communion with us, but repent. You know, that makes us homophobic. Or that we're misogynist because we don't have women priests as priestess. Well, you know. Yeah, we don't. But that doesn't make, you know, but I mean, when, this is what people think, right? Today, it's like, you know, we're an obstacle to be overcome because we're still traditional in our beliefs. And people are trying, I mean, I'm talking about people even in our seminaries that are trying to force progressive ideas on the church. Do you agree with them? Think they're right? Or do you think that's a terrible mistake? If you think that such activities are wrong and they undermine the Christian faith rather than liberate it, then live your life according to the fathers, according to our holy tradition. If you've got some things you've got to straighten out in your life, maybe you need to break a certain habit or, you know, in order to become really, I mean, we're not Orthodox philosophically. We're either Orthodox in how we live or we're not. So we need to live like Orthodox. We need to become people of prayer and people of repentance. And that's more important than activism. Activism has a place, of course, but more important is to become truly and deeply Orthodox ourselves. Like I said once about the early church, how did they respond to the persecutions? Not by writing their congressmen or, you know, starting a Twitter storm. They responded by becoming scary, holy, so that they overcame the world. Well, that's how we do it. We need to turn our homes into houses of prayer. We need to become a people of prayer. Not just saying a few prayers before you dart out the door in the morning, you know, and forgetting to say prayers before you go to bed at night. We need to be in communion with God. We need to pray. We need to train our children to value the praise of God more than the praise of men. So they grow up knowing there's going to be a hostility to their faith. Guard yourself. Don't be scandalized when people say you're a weirdo because you believe stuff that's not popular. What are you, a hater? What are you, a Christian? You know. We need to fill our parishes with people who have come seeking salvation, not just socializing on Sundays. We need to fill our minds with the wisdom of the holy fathers and saints and mothers of the church, and not with what I guess you'd call the anti-wisdom of the world. We need to strive toward holiness, for the prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. Only in this way can the triumph of Orthodoxy continue in the world. You know, we won back then. We won our holy icons. We won our faith and belief in the Incarnation. let's not fritter it away like people are trying to do today. Let's not just take all the blood that we shed to preserve that faith and just say, you know, it's not convenient to believe that stuff anymore. I might lose my job. People might hate me. What is the triumph of Orthodoxy? Ultimately, it is that we continue to believe the truth in a world filled with falsehood. That is the triumph. Truth. Truth that founded the universe. St. John wrote, "For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith." Glory to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.